Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Jessica Destardin, and I am a program coordinator in the MCW Office of Community Engagement. Welcome to the November edition of our monthly series, CE Spotlight. Please note that this session is being recorded. I'd like to begin with a statement from the Office of Community Engagement. We wish to acknowledge the Indigenous people who are past and present stewards of the land on which we pursue our just cause of a healthy community for everyone. To our audience members, please be sure you are muted throughout the presentation. We encourage everyone to use the chat bar freely to share comments or post questions for our guests. We will be monitoring your questions throughout this session, so feel free to send any as they come to you. Please look for information about upcoming guests on our CE website. You can find our series webpage by Googling MCW CE Spotlight. This monthly series features community partners and the important work they are doing for and with the community. We highlight their goals, motivations, and accomplishments, and the ways that they have partnered with people and programs at MCW. Today, we are deeply honored to have three individuals from Friedens Food Pantries, Sofia Torrijos, Valerie McMillan, and Sherry Owsley as our featured guest. We also want to thank Dr. David Nelson, our facilitator today. At this time, I would like to introduce Kelsey Heindel, a program coordinator in the Office of Community Engagement, who will say a few words about Friedens' important work for the community. Kelsey?
Thank you, Jessica. Friedens Food Pantries is a network of food pantries building communities through nourishment. Friedens programs strive to leverage food to build relationships and address the holistic needs of community members. Without healthy food access, it is difficult to manage other life needs. Friedens Community Food Center model leverages food to build equity, create community, and address other social determinants of health, including barriers to education, employment, housing, and safety. Their equity building approach invites all guests, volunteers, and community members to use their gifts and talents in service of others, regardless of food insecurity status. Friedens Food Pantries envisions a more equitable world where systems provide all persons, regardless of age or disability, with resources to thrive. Thank you, Sophia, Cheryl, and Valerie for being our featured spotlight guests today. I would now like to introduce today's facilitator, Dr. David Nelson. Dr. Nelson is an associate professor in the MCW Department of Family and Community Medicine with an expertise working in partnership with diverse communities around issues of health. As a community engaged researcher, he has worked extensively with communities throughout Wisconsin on projects around childhood obesity, promotion of health and wellness, supporting senior caregivers, homelessness and housing instability, and food security. Dr. Nelson's postdoctoral training in community-based participatory research instilled in him the importance of engaging communities throughout the research process as equal partners. His approach is to be culturally humble and to support the health needs of the community as they define those needs. Dr. Nelson, thank you for serving as our facilitator, and I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you, Kelsey, and thank you, team, for supporting the behind the scenes of this. And I want to thank my good friends and the community partners, Sophia, Cheryl, and Val, for joining us today. I feel like I'm at a distinct advantage because I've been working with this organization for the better part of almost 14 years now. I've known Sophia for around 10, Cheryl for a little bit longer than that, and Val I've gotten to know over the last couple of years. And it is a joy to be here and have you join us here today. You know, I just want to ask each of you to tell us a little bit about who you are and what brings you to be in this space of building community and building equity? Sophia, I'd like to start with you and then have you call on your team members to answer that question or something similar to that, please. Go ahead, Sophia.
Sure. Well, first off, thank you guys so much for having our team on this call today. We have such a long partnership with MCW and other healthcare partners in the area. And so it's just really fun to have this conversation with some of my favorite people. And hopefully, I think my favorite part is actually the questions. So yeah, I'm just looking forward to a lively discussion. But who am I? I'm the executive director at Friedens Food Pantries. I've been involved with the organization now for close to 7 years. So and pretty much my entire career has been in nonprofit work. Got my start in community development, specifically working in community organizing and collaboration amongst partners. So it's been fun to take some of that to Friedens. But I'll pass it on to Val.
Thanks, Sophia, and thanks, David, and thank you for everybody who's attending today. It's nice to see everybody here. My name is Valerie McMillan. I am the program manager for Friedens. I have a background in working in restaurants as a cook, and completed my studies at Mount Mary in sustainable nutrition, and I have a real love for community nutrition and bringing people together with food. And there's a lot of really fun ways that we do that at Friedens. And I'm really lucky to be part of such an amazing organization. And I will pass it to the lovely Cheryl.
Thank you, Valerie, Sophia, David, everyone. Thank you guys so much for having us today. My name is Cheryl Owsley. I am the site manager for Friedens Food Pantries. I have been with the organization since 2014, so that's almost 9 years, in several different capacities, starting off as a volunteer, an intern, and now a full-time staff member. My background is in human services. I never really considered food a part of that component of my career until I came to Friedens. And so it's been really important over the last almost 9 years, just developing connections with people and understanding that food is the one thing that no matter who we are, where we are, what we believe, what culture we come from, it's the one thing that can connect us all and help build a bridge so that we can maybe serve other needs, get to know people, you know, make other connections. So it's been really a joy and a privilege and an honor to be a part of this organization.
Thank you, Cheryl. I'd forgotten that you were a volunteer at one time and then an intern. I remember now, though, it does seem like a long time ago. And I love that each of you brings organizing and nutrition and human services to this. You know, if you could tell us, because not everybody's going to be familiar, and I think I sometimes gets away from me that not everybody is familiar with what you all do. And I loved at the beginning when Kelsey was talking about the organization, about building community, and Cheryl just used the word bridge, and how you're focused on equity. Sophia, I want to start with you. Give us kind of that high level, what Friedens Pantries is and what it means to the neighborhoods that you're engaged with in this idea of building community and equity.
That's a big question. So Friedens has been building community through food for over 40 years. And so when we think about how the work started, you know, 40 years ago versus what it looks like today, as you can imagine, the food sector has evolved quite a bit, and particularly food pantries. In fact, we're actually moving away a little bit from that term food pantry to really embrace what's called the community food center model. And so we really like to think of our sites as places of connection, places of intersection around food and other social determinants of health, because as I feel like a lot of people on this call know very well, food is simply a symptom of poverty, one of many symptoms. And so our goal is really to address that root cause. But if you kind of take a bird's eye view of Friedens, we're the largest food center network in Milwaukee. We have 4 sites across the city located in 4 very distinct neighborhoods. In total, we serve around 60,000 people every year, which is a really tremendous number of people that are impacted by this issue. But generally, what you could expect when somebody comes to one of our sites is they're first and foremost greeted with dignity, respect, a warm welcome, which right off the bat is maybe not what they were expecting to receive. But then they get to, select from a variety of foods what they want to take home with them that day. We always offer a wide selection of high quality, nutrient dense, culturally specific foods in all the different areas that you would get when you go to a grocery store, right? And in fact, that's really what we're trying to recreate as much as possible, is a grocery store like experience. We really believe that everybody, no matter who they are, deserves access to the best food in the way that they want to receive it. We've also launched a home delivery program. We have community gardens. hydroponics food rescue program, right? It's a much larger and complicated operation than many people think when they hear the word food pantry. And I think we continue to evolve and innovate.
I love that. And I love the all of the words that you gave with that. But one that stands out to me is the idea of culturally appropriate. And Val, if you could talk about this, I've known that some of the pictures that were there were talking about this nutrient-dense, fresh fruits and vegetables, things that we all should be eating and many people can't be eating. Tell us why this is important from a sustainable nutrition perspective and what it means for the organization to provide food like that to the community that we care about.
Yeah, absolutely. There's sometimes a gap for some people in knowledge when it comes to preparing things that are considered healthier. If you think about what's cheap and what's easy for people to have access to, it's often foods that are not nutrient dense, and that sometimes requires preparation or, you know, there's oftentimes a gap in knowledge. And frankly, there's a gap in knowledge sometimes with our volunteers when they come in and help us sort some of this fresh food. And there's like an education process in that as well. But so we, with the food center model, we are able to provide an education component that involves recipe development of food that people are going to be receiving that week, from the produce that we receive from our food banks, the produce that we receive from our gleaning partners. And if gleaning is a term that's unfamiliar to anybody here, it's a food rescue. It's the idea where grocery stores often, and sometimes even other organizations, have food that they don't, you know, that they're going to be throwing away, but is still good. We work with partners to recover food from places like Trader Joe's, from schools, from Costco, and sometimes other food pantries. So we work with a lot of different partners in the community to try and bring in as much fresh food as possible that we can distribute in our pantries. And again, with that food center model, I think that's really important that we can provide the education component as well. And being able to provide these things at a food pantry is really important. You know, I will tell you, I was in the store just yesterday, and it's a store that I absolutely love, but organic red peppers were $6.99 a pound. And if you think about that, to get two red peppers to throw into your chili or something like that is going to cost you $7 is absolutely outrageous. So we're really grateful that we're able to provide so much fresh produce to our community members. And again, when we get things in that might seem either unfamiliar, foreign, or there's a learning curve, we see that as an opportunity to maybe do a food demonstration that day at the pantry and be like, hey, this is how you do that. This is how you use this. This is how you cut this up. This is, you know, how you need to cook it and prepare it. So we're using education to breach that gap and make it easier for people to introduce those more nutrient dense foods into their diet.
It's fantastic. I'm going to share this because she's right here. But Cheryl, one of my favorite pictures that I have of you is when you and Karen were at our farm and you were picking garlic. And it's that notion of fresh fruits and vegetables that we provide to folks at peppers at $6.99 a pound. I don't shop. And so that's mind boggling. But Cheryl, as a site manager, what does it mean to be able to provide good food to the people that you support?
Instantly coming to my mind is, so if people aren't familiar, Friedens translated means peace. And so I think being able to provide, you know, nutrient-dense foods, you know, fresh produce especially, it provides peace of mind. So similar to Val, was recently at the store and just mind-boggling at the price of certain items, even now versus like 6 months ago. And if for me that felt like, oh, this is a little bit too much, I can only imagine what it's like for the families that we serve who frequently experience food insecurity, dealing with poverty issues. And so I think when they come to our pantries, having people come in, we have everything displayed. We have a variety, mostly familiar items, some not so familiar. So that does provide a component of education where we can say, well, someone's like, what is this? And staff or if a volunteer is aware, they can explain what it is, how to prepare it. But I think it just gives people a peace of mind that this is one part of their diet that they maybe are not going to be stressing over, at least for the 5 to 7 days that of food that we provide. And I think that's huge because one of the, Val said this earlier, you know, when people are shopping, most of the more affordable foods are usually not the best or have the highest, you know, nutritional value. So people want to stretch their dollars and their first thought is, let me get as much of something I can get for my money versus let me get the best stuff that's going to sustain health and energy and provide, you know, all the nutrients that I and my family need. So to have to make that hard choice is difficult. But when they come to our sites, it's, again, it just gives them a peace of mind that, hey, I don't have to worry about this particular part of my diet. And we've made it so that people can come in any day that we're open at any of our sites if they want simply just produce. Like, that's something that I think the community really appreciates. And that's definitely something we're going to continue as long as we are able to provide it.
I love that phrase, peace of mind, and this idea of the community food center model that Sophia and Val had mentioned. I want you to take us into some details, Sophia, about the mission and why it's so important that we do what we do to give that peace of mind. Would you mind speaking into that for a bit? And then we'll riff on that with the other two guests.
Yeah, absolutely. So I'm so lucky to work with such an incredible team, right? I think they're really making me think about our work differently. And our work is, our backgrounds are so interdisciplinary. I love that. But I think one thing that we all have in common is that we put people first. And yes, you know, that's not to say we don't put a lot of thought into the food and the services that we provide, because we absolutely do. You know, any of the food that we give at the pantry is food that you or I would eat. I saw the same eggs on the shelf the other day that are the eggs that I bought at Outpost. So that's a good feeling. But I think that at the end of the day, our work deals with trauma. And many of the individuals who use our services are suffering the effects of trauma, and whether that's trauma from addictions in the family, of abuse, of living in neighborhoods where rates of violence are higher, gun violence is higher, or simply just the effects of the chronic stress in the body from poverty. We're really dealing with individuals who sometimes have a really hard time trusting, who have a really hard time feeling valued and seen. And so I think that the food really does become this conduit to opening the door to relationship with someone and restoring place in society and saying, hey, I see you, you matter. And in fact, why don't you come and help us at the pantry? So that's, speaking of equity, a really important aspect of our model is that approximately 30% of our volunteer base, and on any given day that could be higher as well, but a large percentage of our volunteer base are individuals who have lived experience with food insecurity and are either, you know, maybe current, past, maybe even present users of the food pantry. And that's not by accident. That's a really intentional thing that we build into our models, that we ask people to come back and serve as a way of indicating that there aren't givers and receivers, right? The lines between those roles are blurred because everybody has something that they can give to their community. And everybody has something they can learn. I say this to people all the time, that I have personally learned so much more, I think, than I've ever given. And that's okay. It's a mutual process. It's something that we do in step with our community. Even thinking about the way that we structure our leadership, members of our staff have experience with food insecurity. Members of our board have experience with food insecurity. We really want this process to be driven by the community so that we can always not only be adaptive to their needs, but create a culture where everybody is extremely valued.
Yeah, you mentioned the hallmark of community engagement is that we are co-learning and we have bidirectionality in all phases. And I saw that both Cheryl and Val were nodding, and I'm gonna come back to that. But I think we have a short video that that I'm going to ask Ajay to queue up that kind of doubles down on some of the things that Sophia is saying here. Ajay, can you queue the video, please?
We are both giving and receiving. If we come here from the patriarchal position of I am here solely to give and you have nothing of value to give back, we're just perpetuating the things that are sick and toxic in our social systems. We may not change the world, but we can live the world differently while we're here. Here, we cannot rightly give to someone else in their vulnerability if we're not willing to make ourselves vulnerable first.
You know, I know that they were double timing it, but sometimes it seems like the volunteers go that fast in real time. So I love that video, and I love the saying, we all love Max, and we love what he brings to the equation. And somebody indicated we can live the world differently while we were here. Kelsey, love that. Cheryl, I got to come back to the realities that are facing our community members. When you talk about teaching about recipes, what are some of the conditions that people live in when it comes to being able to prepare food and even to have the things that they need in order to prepare a meal for their families? And what are the things that you're learning and teaching in this process?
So I, in my capacity as site manager, I spend and have spent quite a lot of time speaking with different community members. And we often encounter individuals who, maybe don't have a permanent residence, or if they have a residence, they don't necessarily have like a stove, they only have like a hot plate, or they only have a microwave. And those are things that are preventative of people taking, choosing the food that that we offer. You know, we do provide about 5 to 7 days worth of food, and some people won't take things simply because they have no way to prepare them. So just learning that, you know, we have some people who don't even have something like a can opener. And I'm, you know, thinking a lot of us probably own one. Some of us own an electric can opener, but we have individuals that we serve that don't even have just the regular one. And it seems simple to say, you can go to Dollar Tree and get one for, well, $1.25 now, but you can go to Dollar Tree and get one for less than $2. But if someone doesn't have that, because they have to use that to get somewhere, it's like, that's a barrier to them, you know, being able to feed themselves at least, you know. And again, we had talked about the bridge, you know, we provide enough food hopefully to bridge a gap between the next step. But if they can't take something because they can't open it, they can't prepare it, it just makes things more difficult. So what I've seen a lot lately with donations is that there's quite a few items with pop tops, which helps. So if someone doesn't have a can opener and they indicate that, if we ourselves don't have one to provide, we lean in more toward giving them items that are easier to open. If someone is saying they don't have a stove, simply a microwave, trying to make sure we have items on hand that they can prepare in the microwave. If someone is saying they just simply don't know how to prepare something, if we have that knowledge, you know, I've even looked up stuff online in the moment, like, well, here's how you make, you know, chicken or something, like, because some people really just don't know how to prepare it, and that'll keep them from taking. So it really just, all this to say, it's important that we communicate with the people that we are helping, the community members that we're serving, to know the needs, so that as we continue to move toward a, you know, community food center, we can address those needs as much as possible. Then we know what to ask for of our, you know, stakeholders, our supporters. And, you know, we can meet those needs. And obviously, we're not going to be able to 100% all the time get people's needs met, you know, but we will definitely do our best. But it does start with having that communication and having an ear and eyes in the community as to what the needs are and how we can fulfill them.
I love that. Val, you get a slightly different question. What's it like to make a meal with someone who comes to one of our guests that comes to our pantry? What have you learned in that space?
Well, a couple of things that are very different. One of the nice things about like creating the food demonstration at one of our pantries is talking to folks when they come up. It gives me a chance to sort of survey and ask questions of, do you have a stove at home? Do you have a whisk? Do you have like little tools that a lot of us might take for granted that comes, you know, standard in our kitchens? And then that helps me determine, you know, what I might prepare the next time, or what type of recipe we might want to provide to people, because I'm able to have those conversations. But the bigger and maybe more important thing that sometimes comes out of preparing food and sharing that time with other people at the pantry is, you know, when you break bread together, people open up and they start to talk. And sometimes that's what somebody might need in their day, you know, like, you know, people think, oh yeah, you're just a food pantry, you give out food. No, but food is powerful, and sharing food, breaking bread together, cooking together, it's powerful. And, you know, we talk about how we leverage food to build community. This is how we do it. I have learned so much about people, and sometimes when they are able to sort of open up and tell me, you know, what's going on in their life right now, what are their troubles? You know, sometimes I just, an ear, just somebody to listen to them, and validate, their experience. And other times I might be able to provide them a resource that can help them in their daily life or whatever their struggle is. I might, you know somebody who can help them develop their resume if they've just lost their job. I might be able to connect them with a healthcare provider if they're, you know, if they start talking about their nutrition needs, or, you know, a doctor told me I need to do this and I don't know what to do. You know, I can make those connections with people. So preparing food with other people and sharing food with people who come through the pantry is just a really, really powerful opportunity for us to do so much more within our community. And it's been a transformative experience for me since I've been at Friedens.
You have also helped to transform the organization in the short time you've been there. We appreciate you. Sophia, I got to come back to you and really speak to our audience about the realities that we are facing right now with the combination of inflation and the resources that are going away. What are the realities right now for the clients that come to Friedens?
Yeah, I was actually thinking about that when Cheryl was talking, just about some of the barriers that people have to food right now in our country. I think we can all agree that we are living some pretty unprecedented times. I came into Friedens, and within less than a year of my time being executive director, the pandemic hit. And let me tell you, I don't know if I would have, that was like baptism by fire. I don't know. We saw a need and we all just reacted instinctively and we pivoted our services in a massive way. You know, I think a lot of us experienced that in a lot of places. And I think a few things happened and are happening. You know, there's obviously the recession, which as research has shown, it's not like an immediate impact on people's pockets. Usually there's a bit of a delay, and that's kind of what we're seeing now at the pantries, is that there was an initial spike in terms of client volume at the very beginning of the pandemic. And then kind of as a result of some of those COVID-related policies, people were getting stimulus checks, increased unemployment benefits, increased food stamps, right? There was a lot of support that we certainly saw a lot of people and new visitors coming to the pantry. Our percentage of first-time visitors came up, increased. But I think those pandemic-era policies were really, really helpful to keep people afloat. And what we're seeing now is with the rollback of those policies, we've already seen it go into effect with the food stamps going away, some of the unemployment, and we're seeing client volume go up again. And that's happening at the same time that inflation's going up. What wages are stagnant, and then also support for purchasing of food is going away. So it's kind of this confluence of a lot of factors right now that we're definitely keeping our eye on stuff for January, because that's when even more things are going into effect. but yeah.
Thank you for that. I appreciate you expressing that. You did it so well. Cheryl, you've been around for almost a decade, and I know you've been at all of our sites. Talk about some of the people that you've encountered, both as volunteers and have people that have come for food. Just give us a few stories. I just think that's a wonderful way for us to express what the organization does in the space.
There was one earlier this week, Monday, there was a woman that came in and she just was being difficult. But you know, you often, you know, with people and they're dealing with things like poverty and such, you know, it can manifest itself out with attitude, and you see that immediately and you kind of get guarded because you just don't want to interact with someone. But part of our jobs is to make sure that people are feeling comfortable. They understand that we provide safe spaces. And so the woman was just not very happy with pretty much every aspect of what we were doing. But at the end, you know, she was very grateful that we were there to help her out. And it just, you know, it humbles you just when you encounter people who maybe don't have the best hygiene. And sometimes you kind of want to pull back, but then you have to remember there may be a barrier to them having access to water, to hygiene products and things like that. And it really does just humble you when you decide to see past their need, see past their present circumstances, have a conversation. And then, you know, you realize A, they're a human being, same as you, that B, all of us at some point in our lives, no matter what our economic status is, we'll need a hand anywhere we go. And whenever they come to one of our sites, it's like, it's really important for us the minute they walk in, hi, how are you? You know, we provide like coffee, water, just making sure that they understand we're a little bit different than most places. We want to make sure that you feel from start to finish like you're valued, respected, you're seen, and you're human. And I think that's important. And I've seen that at every single site. Where we get different types of people, you know, but at the end of the day, the majority of the people that we serve are just wonderful individuals with great stories, impactful stories. I first coming into Friedens thought, you know, I'm going to do such great stuff and help the community, and the community's helped me way more than I even could have imagined that they would. I've learned a lot. I've been humbled a lot. I've, been taught a lot from some really awesome people, and that's volunteers, community members, our board members, you know, donors. It's just been an incredible ride to be on and meet so many different types of people and learn so much. And every site has, you know, different types of characters, I will say, like, but overall it's just really fun, warm, loving people who really truly believe you know, in their own worth. And we just want to help them realize that for the 10 to 15 minutes they may be on our sites.
I love that. Val, can you talk a bit about some of the innovation that you're doing and the engagement with the community around the hydroponics, the gardens that you have out front, and what does it mean to have someone stick their hands in the soil, right?
You're asking me. You're the expert on sticking your hands in the soil. it's phenomenal. This last year, I had managed our indoor and outdoor community gardens, and I am not the most skilled at growing things. I always have really grand ambitions, but it was a wonderful opportunity for me to engage with service learners from local colleges who come in and spend some of their time with us, and then also further engage with the community. So we had some wonderful interns who were passionate about gardening, and like I really worked with them to let them like lead the charge on, what do we want to do with the gardens this year? How do we make this meaningful? We clearly aren't a farm and can't grow enough food to really feed our community in a meaningful way. However, we can use these gardens to create beautiful calming spaces. We can create an ability to you know, I mean, we can take a hydroponic tower and grow enough herbs to give to everybody or to garnish our food demonstrations. And we talked to, you know, it gave us an opportunity to survey the community. What did they want to see us grow? What did they want to learn how to grow? And we've done things like, I had an intern lead the charge on growing a beautiful Three Sisters garden outside of our Dispensa de la Paz pantry. And it was absolutely beautiful. And of course, we only grew, you know, three stalks of corn because it's a raised bed garden. However, we were able to harvest this beautiful corn. It's an heirloom variety called Glass Gem. And it's a popping corn. You can't make a lot out of it. However, we were able to take that and make Christmas ornaments on it and out of it and use the Christmas ornaments and our tree and cathedral square. So that represent the Friedens community. So there's fun, creative ways we can do things with the gardens. The hydroponic towers are really fun. We sometimes pull them out during food demonstrations. If we're making a soup, we might trim some parsley or some cilantro and garnish the soup. If a community member, we'd have one community member in particular who really just every time we grow kale, she wants as much of it as she can take. And so we're happy to provide that. And then in addition to all of that, we're also now working with a group of students from UWM who are building us these really innovative composting containers out of these giant plastic bins and then repurposed pallets from our pantry. And we're really excited. That's going to probably be launching on Friday. Those students have been building them for weeks and their final project is next week. So it's a really wonderful way for us to engage with students, volunteers, community members. It's like just this amazing tool that we have at our disposal to bring people together over growing something beautiful. And I absolutely love it.
I love that. And then there was one of the pictures, some friends of ours grow some plants and they give them to the people and give them to me that we can grow. And I think there's something visceral about that, about people growing something, even something small, like a tomato or a piece of corn, which it's not going to feed the neighborhood, but there's something where it's like, you know, where your food comes from, and then you can do something with that. Sophia, when you hear these stories, like Cheryl said, and Valerie just spoke about, what makes you think of when we talk about community food centers and what might lie in the future? Because I think we can have a blind spot that said if people are food insecure, that everything else is cool in their life, where we know that if people are insecure in one area, they're more than likely to be insecure in another area. But so you can you talk us through about what it may mean for us in the future and where we may go with some of this?
Sure. Before I do that, I just want to add to something Val said and what you said, David, though, about like I'm still to this day surprised by how many people have no idea what their food looks like before it's like packaged and processed and like put into all these different shapes and made into a noodle. And I mean, it's really amazing how disconnected we are from our food system. I'm thinking about how Brussels sprouts grow, right? It's on this huge stalk. And the first time I encountered that was at Friedens and I was like, what is that? I didn't know, right? So it's just pretty amazing like how much I feel like I've learned about where my food comes from, the policies that shape our food systems, and truly how much you and I can do to influence that too. But when I think about the future of the food sector, and I guess in particular with Friedens, I guess a few things come to mind, right? Number one would be collaboration. I think for way too many years, people have thought of food as this siloed thing. And even within the food sector, everybody's just kind of doing their own thing, right? Like, I can't tell you, like, it's strange to me to think about this now, but like farmers are kind of, they're growing their food and then food retailers are selling their food and then food pantries are doing their thing. And like, we're all doing the same thing here. So I think more often now we're seeing more collaboration, partly as a result of the pandemic, right? It really forced people to think differently and solve problems more creatively. Friedens is a member of the Milwaukee Food Council, which is a consortium of different people working on food issues. And we've come to realize that as an organization, we touch every aspect of the food life cycle. Like we're growing the food, we're distributing it, we're preparing it together, we're eating it together, we're even recycling the food together. And so I think that maybe leads me to like what the second thing I think on the horizon for us is just to think outside the box, right? For way too long, when people hear food pantry, immediately in their mind, they're thinking like some kind of like dark little cupboard in a basement, maybe, or they're thinking of lines of people lined up, like that. Like if you think of the Great Depression, right? That's what I used to think of before I worked in this sector. And so I think more often you're saying, hey, that's not the vibe that we're going for anymore. We really want people to, I want them to want to come. I don't want them to feel like they have to come. I want them to get up and think, oh my gosh, this, I get to go to the food pantry today or the community food center. Or, you know, maybe even the greatest compliment would be like, wait, what? I just left a food pantry. I didn't know, right? Pay what you can, grocery stores. There's so many different models out there right now that I think are pushing back on some of that. And then I think like just lastly to think about how we as an organization continue to incorporate equity, equitable practices into our work, community leadership, and building on what we have as an organization that already has so many community members volunteering with us. I would love to take that deeper and really develop greater leadership. Too many folks are not aware, I think, of our food policies, and I'd love to get more neighbors involved in that in a future state.
That is a grant waiting to happen. I love that idea. Cheryl, can you continue where Sophia left off? And can you tell us why equity in the food space is so important?
I think because it brings, again, I call back to what I said earlier about peace of mind, comfort, security. I think that it's one of the worst things in the world for people to have to agonize over how they're going to feed themselves or their families. I think it's even worse when they go to a place that is meant to help and they don't feel welcome and they don't feel safe and they don't feel like they're going to leave better than they arrived. So I think, you know, just making sure that, again, people are treated fairly, that everyone has the same opportunity to be educated, to be fed, to be loved, that's pretty important. And looking past, again, people's circumstances, looking past their, you know, ethnic makeup, their economic state, their age, their, you know, gender, like those things, if we bring everyone together and they're all from different sectors of the population, and everyone's being treated the same, I think people will feel more comfortable seeking assistance. If any of you on this call or in this meeting have ever been to a pantry, I have when I was younger. It's kind of like just Sophia described, where it was really kind of dark, almost factory-like. The people were simply just there to, here, please take this, get out. There was no choice. There were very, very limited fresh options. And you just didn't, I just remember leaving feeling like charity. And we don't want people to feel like charity. We want people to feel like, hey, you know what? Welcome to our food center. We've got education, we've got resources, we've got food, you know. And like Sophia also said, you know, we want people to leave like, that was a food pantry. Like, we want to turn the stigma of what food pantries are on their head and have people really understand it is about community, it is about making sure that everyone, no matter what, is going to be fed for as long as we are needed. And I think, you know, obviously our dream, or at least my dream, is that, you know, we work ourselves out of a job, that one day we wake up, there is no food insecurity, you know. But right now, where we are, the world we live in, that is a reality. And our goal is to make sure that that reality is as painless and, you know, difficult as possible, less difficult as possible. We don't want people to feel like they're more of a burden than they are a blessing.
It's fantastic. And you went from a phrase that I cringed at, the idea of agonizing over choices or the lack thereof, but then you moved to love. So we went from agony to love, which I think is a powerful continuum. And Max will say things like, we don't do charity, we do justice, to your point about the idea of charity here. Val, talk about what gives you hope in this space in the time that you've been here and how you see that translating to future action.
I get hope from the people. Like it's always the people. It comes back to the people. It's so funny. I used to think that I was a little bit more cynical, but the deeper I get into this work and the more people that I've met, the more hopeful I am for just about every damn aspect of my life, and the world and the future. And it's so amazing. Come volunteer with us and you'll get that same high. It's pretty amazing. It's pretty great. Just talking to people every day, and the community members constantly keep me on my toes and surprise me and share things with me in their life. I think Sophia said earlier that, you know, sometimes she feels like she gets more than she gives. And I feel the same is absolutely true. And I think if more people understood that, if more people could see the value that so many individuals that are often overlooked by larger society have to give to the larger community. I mean, I sound like a hippy dippy optimist after being in this field, but I truly am. I am inspired every day by the work, and it drives me, and it makes me forward thinking on how I can better serve this community that's welcomed me with their open arms. And I just want to do right by every person who comes through our door.
So you went from cynicism to optimism. I love it. Sophia, you lead the organization. Tell us what keeps you up at night.
Oh my gosh. Like, I feel like I should have a therapy couch behind me or something like that. Like David, my therapist. I think I'm very lucky to work with such a great team and board and volunteers, right? A lot of people who do such amazing work that I feel that's definitely one aspect I feel good about. But I think that speaking from an organization perspective, capacity is always really hard. I think too often people have this concept of like, well, you just give food away. Like that's easy, you know? And so sometimes I feel like it's our struggle to communicate how complicated that work is, how much goes into it, the nutrition policies, the safety policies, think of all the work that goes into running a grocery store. You know, you wouldn't expect someone to run, pick and save, like with two staff, right? So I think sometimes it's communicating the impact of what we do and the fact that there's so much more that we do that maybe goes unseen, like even some of our cross-sector partnerships, right? We partner with healthcare entities. We have some really cool partnerships actually happening with Children's right now where we're hoping to screen people in emergency rooms and clinics for food insecurity to get them connected to food pantries, right? Like this understanding that food is health and that it's not siloed. So I think that's maybe keeps me up at night. And I think also just some of our, which I mentioned policy before, but how truly important it is for people to advocate for this work, to communicate the importance of it with their local lawmakers, their state and federal lawmakers, because when we saw a lot of support during the pandemic, it really made the food system a lot stronger. And now I fear that the rug is getting pulled out from under people who were really accustomed to, they finally caught their breath, right? Like for they were just paycheck to paycheck. And then, you know, suddenly like, they're like, oh, okay, I can finally get a leg up. And I do worry that the rug is going to get pulled out from under people. And I would be remiss if I did not mention that the immigrant community has always had immense barriers to all of, they didn't actually get to access any of that because of their status. So that's a whole separate topic, but yeah, I guess maybe those are a small list of things that keep me up at night.
Well, it's the reality that we face. And so in our last minute or so, I'm going to ask each of you for a word or phrase that makes you think of Friedens Pantries. And my word or phrase is joy. Cheryl Owsley, give us your word or phrase when you think of Friedens Pantries.
Love.
I love it. Valerie McMillan, give us a word or phrase what you think of when you think of Friedens Pantries.
All right, I'm sneaking a little bit from you, but it was mine first. It was joyful chaos.
Oh, we can double down on our words or phrase. Sophia Torrios, the executive director, give us your word or phrase and give us a thought to leave on, please.
My word will be nourishment. And I think just get involved. Like, we can all do something, even if it's small. Even if it's having a conversation with somebody that looks different or you wouldn't normally approach, I think that's a huge part of this, right? Get involved, whether that's at Friedens or somewhere else, you know, that's the point.
That is fantastic. And I want to thank each of you for bringing me joy and joyful chaos, especially when I didn't follow the questions exactly as we laid them out, but you guys did wonderful. Building community together. Thank you, Kamara. We appreciate that. Outstanding session. Thank you, Dr. Moyer. Hey, Jai, would you tell us what we got coming up? So we're going to take a little break for the holidays. We want to thank you all for joining us today. We're going to have a slide that says, we'll post this on our website for the Spotlight Series. Fantastic session. Thank you. It was all due to our guest. If you go to the next slide so people can get to Making a Difference. If you are interested, don't ask me how they do it, but if you hold your camera up to that, you'll get to Friedens Pantries site and you can sign up for a volunteer. You can give some money. We always will take your money, write a check to us. And we wish you all the best during this holiday season, however you celebrate. And we hope that you will join us in 2023. And on that, we thank you and we bid you adieu this evening. Thanks, everybody.